Hello, and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about tuning shared buffers and whether 25% of RAM is a good choice. Now, I want to start with this tweet by Andres Freund that he wrote a couple of years ago. In this tweet, he was pointing out that the often repeated recommendation to not exceed 25% of RAM shared buffers in Postgres is wrong. But a test that he ran back then was using a PGBench with scale 1500 that's roughly a 22 gigabyte database, and was doing this on a local machine with a fast SSD drive and with 32 gigabytes of RAM. He was testing with both 1 gigabyte of shared buffers, 8 gigabyte, aka 25%, and 24 gigabytes, which notably was slightly larger than the amount of data that he was working with. Back then, what he was showing is that if you pick 25%, that would actually give you the worst performance out of the three, versus if you pick 24 gigabytes, that would actually get you the best performance. The main point here was if your working set fits into memory, then choosing to share buffers that encompasses your working set gets you the best performance. More recently, Sean from the EDB team was running a comprehensive set of tests to figure out how to set shared buffers effectively. Earlier this month, he started by running tests with an HP DL360 server with local hard drives. This is also a system that has 64 gigabytes of RAM. First, he was doing a PGBench with a database size of 110 gigabytes, so about double the size of RAM. He was testing different values of shared buffers up to 32 gigabytes, so 50%. For the PGBench test, the performance did get better when there was a higher shared buffers, like for example, 50% of RAM. Sean was also looking at PG buffer cache. What that shows you is how Postgres reuses its pages versus to go and fetch new pages. The usage count here is essentially a representation of whether something was reused or something had to be fetched from disk or the operating system cache. The higher usage count is better, and the maximum is 5. So usage count 5, that means that a good portion of the workload was in shared buffers and so could be reused, versus usage count 0 or 1 means it's less likely to be the case. In this PGBench test, some portion of the workload was reusable, but not a lot actually. And really what you can see here is that this represents a large portion of the working set exceeding shared buffers, and that's why we have a lot of turnaround in shared buffers. It was also running a tpproxy benchmark. Instead of PGBench, which kind of goes all over the place, tpproxy has a smaller active working set. You can see that a much larger shared buffers did give tremendous performance improvements. And the reason for that is that a lot of the data was in shared buffers and could be reused. It was also testing a tpproc-h benchmark. In this particular case, the lower shared buffers performed better and gave you better performance. And the reason for that is that shared buffers wasn't really effective at caching the right pages. And so Postgres was essentially taking away space from the operating system cache that could have instead cached things more effectively. Now, earlier this week, Sean re-ran these tests with 128 gigabytes of RAM, double the RAM from last time, and enterprise class SSDs. What's interesting with the PGBench here is that the PGBench performed exactly the same, no matter the shared buffer setting. This PGBench had a working set of 219 gigabytes. So this means that it was clearly beyond the RAM, but because the cost of fetching a page was so cheap, because these enterprise class SSDs, they're just really fast, it didn't really make a big difference how to tune shared buffers here, because you didn't actually get that much benefit anyway versus getting it from disk. He also ran a tpproxy benchmark again. And there you do actually see that higher shared buffers did benefit. Even though these SSDs are pretty fast, there's still a cost to going to the Linux page cache and then actually going to disk. So it's just more CPU cycles that you're spending. Whereas if something is in a buffer cache, that's still going to be faster. We can see high usage counts. So this type of workload did perform better with a higher shared buffer cache. Last but not least, he also did again run the tpproc-h benchmarks, and there is still a benefit here to lower shared buffers for data warehousing type workload. Now, Sean makes two conclusions here. First, he says that for warehouse type workload, you should consider using the default of 128 megabytes of shared buffers. The second thing he argues is that you should continue to follow a 25% rule for OLTP systems. And I would disagree slightly here. I actually think that Sean's data shows that that's not necessarily the best choice. I would also argue that the trade-off here is if you have a certain portion of your working set that can be reused, higher shared buffers is going to be better. However, a larger shared buffers makes it more expensive to get new pages because the clock sweep algorithm Postgres has to look at more data. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.